The elder days of our planet saw the evolution of many creatures strange and surreal, and few time periods were so amassed with oddballs, misfits, and all-around anomalies as the Cambrian. The Cambrian began approximately 542 million years ago, and saw the advent of many of the major animal groups alive today, and of all the great family trees that set down their roots in this long-lost time, none branched out into a more wondrous and seemingly limitless array of dazzling forms than the arthropods. Today, arthropods comprise over 80% of animal species known, and with their hard external skeletons and jointed limbs, they are easily distinguishable from anything else alive, even their closest relatives. But the boundary between the arthropods and their next of kin wasn't always so bold and clear. Nearer the dawn of their unfathomably long reign, they shared the planet with an assortment of odd creatures that blurred the line between arthropods proper and their distant relations. These intermediates, so to speak, form a group known as the stem-arthropods, comprising a number of extinct lineages that are considered to have been more closely related to modern arthropods than they are to the arthropods' closest living relatives. And some, it's safe to say, were among the most otherworldly life forms ever to grace our planet. Many, unfortunately, remain shrouded in obscurity, entirely unappreciated by all but the nerdiest of paleontology aficionados, but a handful have at least left a faint but tangible mark upon the mainstream. And of these, few are more iconic and recognizable than Opabinia regalis. This fascinating creature first came to light in 1911, when its remains were unearthed in Canada's Burgess shale, now a world-famous fossil site. And a formal description of the animal, along with numerous other organisms found alongside it, was published the following year. Since then, a number of additional specimens of Opabinia have been found, preserving many aspects of the animal's anatomy in exquisite detail. Yet even though the completeness of some of Opabinia's remains allowed this creature to be reimagined with relative confidence, its bizarre appearance nevertheless seems to have been difficult for some to take seriously, to the point that a reconstruction of the animal displayed at a presentation was met with derisive laughter from the audience. Opabinia regalis was a small but elongated creature reaching lengths of up to 7 centimeters, with a multi-segmented body lined with rows of overlapping flaps, terminating in a fan-shaped tail. But it was the front end that made Opabinia so remarkable. Upon its rounded head was set 5 eyes, each borne aloft by a short stalk and resembling a little mushroom. And if the presence of 5 eyes wasn't strange enough, extending from the front of Opabinia's head was a long, flexible proboscis tipped with a 2-pronged claw that was, in turn, adorned with a set of small spines. This proboscis, contrary to what appearances may suggest, was not a mouth, though its armature nevertheless indicates that it was almost certainly used to aid in feeding. And the position of the animal's true mouth is an oddity in itself. It's situated behind the proboscis and points backwards. This strange orientation would render the mouth impractical for use on its own, making the long, flexible proboscis a necessity to capture food and deliver it hence. Given Opabinia bore no signs of tough jaws or any substantial weaponry, it was likely restricted to consuming small, soft prey items. The rest of Opabinia's body, though it may boast an overall less bemusing assortment of features, is subject to perhaps a greater degree of ambiguity. A study published in 1996 put forward a somewhat controversial proposal concerning the possible presence of walking limbs situated on the animal's underside. Some fossils of Opabinia exhibit a series of triangular patches, which may represent what was once a set of soft, stumpy limbs, though they have also been interpreted as muscles or extensions of the gut. More recent research has lent further credence to the possibility that Opabinia had walking limbs, though a clear-cut consensus regarding this particular aspect of the animal's anatomy is still yet to be reached. So for now, it's difficult to definitively say whether Opabinia was solely a swimmer, or perhaps a crawler as well. Opabinia, as aforementioned, belongs to a group broadly referred to as the stem-arthropods, an assortment of extinct creatures of nearer affinity to modern arthropods than to the closest living relatives of arthropods. The most basal members of this group, that is to say, those whose ancestors diverged earliest, are somewhat informally known as the Lobopodians. These were vaguely caterpillar-like animals, often with elongated bodies and stumpy legs. Unlike arthropods proper, they were for the most part soft-bodied, though the recently described Lobopodian Entothoraeus sinostris seems to have convergently evolved armor plating reminiscent of that possessed by arthropods. Opabinia, meanwhile, sits further up the family tree, closer to the true arthropods. It's part of a taxon known as the Dinocharidids, which also contains the so-called gilled Lobopodians and Radiodonts, the latter of which includes the famous Anomalocaris. Dinocharidids are united by the presence of lateral flaps along their bodies, and both the Radiodonts and gilled Lobopodians also possessed a pair of fierce, grasping appendages at the front. Opabinia, with its single, clawed proboscis, was a little different in this regard, and this trademark feature is currently thought to have evolved via the fusion of two separate appendages. Among the Dinocharidids, Opabinia sits higher up the family tree than the gilled Lobopodians, but below the Radiodonts, which are considered to be the most closely related to modern arthropods out of the three Dinocharidid lineages. But the boughs, branches, and twigs of Opabinia's family tree were not always so neat and orderly. Around the 1970s, Opabinia's relation to other animals was an altogether more confusing affair. Given its bizarre appearance, with a befuddling blend of features familiar and fantastical, Opabinia's position in the Tree of Life, now reasonably well established, was initially somewhat of a perplexing matter. Some thought it to be a worm-like creature, or even something entirely separate from any living animal phylum, and there was a certain degree of confusion not only about Opabinia itself, but life in the Cambrian as a whole. Opabinia was the first species discovered in the Burgess Shale that could not be confidently assigned to any animal group, and the apparent anatomical uniqueness of it, along with some of its contemporaries like Anomalocaris, drew some, notably famed evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould, to conclude that the animals of the Cambrian constituted a so-called riot of experimental morphologies that are not represented today. The presence of creatures like these, ones that appeared to defy modern classification, was taken as evidence that the Cambrian period saw an uncharacteristically sudden explosion in biodiversity, evolution's experimental phase, so to speak. But over the following decades, the discovery of numerous other Cambrian organisms exhibiting varying degrees of similarity with both these extinct oddities and modern arthropods served to bridge the gap somewhat, allowing for the placement of these once unclassifiable creatures as part of the arthropod stem group. This much more seamless integration into the Tree of Life also indicated that the diversification of the animal kingdom over the course of the Cambrian, while certainly rapid, was not so drastic or explosive as to imply the influence of unusual or unexplainable mechanisms or factors. And the common phrase, Cambrian explosion, widely used to this day, can be considered something of a hyperbolic description. Even though it no longer sits in taxonomic limbo, Opabinia undeniably appears something of an oddball, a creature utterly unparalleled and one of a kind, even by the otherworldly standards of the Cambrian. But in fact, this enchanting little creature wasn't quite as much of an anatomical misfit as one may think. A 2022 publication details the redescription of a mysterious little fossil that had hitherto been identified as the remains of an Anomalocaridid Radiodont. Further examination, however, revealed a close affinity to Opabinia. It too had five eyes, albeit arranged somewhat differently to those of its better-known relative, and it also wielded a flexible clawed proboscis. The animal was named Utaurora with the genus name Utaurora jointly referring to the state of Utah within which it was discovered, and the Roman goddess Aurora. Meanwhile, the species epithet Comosa can mean either hairy or leafy, and in this case, both are relevant. For Utaurora possessed a dense covering of fine filaments called setal blades over its back, giving it an overall rather fluffy appearance. And the seven pairs of flaps that formed its tail were distinctly leaf-shaped. Opabinia was also adorned in setal blades, though unlike those of Utaurora, their occurrence was restricted to the lateral flaps and they were not present on the main body. The tail fins of the two species were also distinct, with that of Opabinia comprising three pairs of flaps with rounded tips, as opposed to the seven pointed pairs found in Utaurora. Needless to say, these two close relatives were classified under the same family, the Opabiniidae, a taxon that had been erected decades earlier to accommodate the eponymous Opabinia, which, until the description of Utaurora, had long been the sole member of the group. So with the discovery of Utaurora, Opabinia was no longer quite the wild card it once was, and the new additions to the Opabiniid catalogue don't end there either. In the very same year that Utaurora was formally described, another ancient enigma came to light. This is Mieridduryn bonnii, a minuscule creature scarcely over a centimeter in length, but whose fossil remains may be of a significance far beyond its diminutive size. For unlike Opabinia and Utaurora, Mieridduryn hails not from the Cambrian, but from the Middle Ordovician, and its discovery may thus indicate that the Opabiniids, which were previously believed to have gone extinct in the Cambrian, may have survived over 40 million years longer than once thought. It could also shed some light on the aforementioned leggy conundrum, for Mieridduryn's fossils bear evidence of soft, stumpy limbs, and if this animal is indeed of close relation to Opabinia, then it adds further plausibility to the idea that the latter also possessed walking limbs. However, it is worth noting that the status of Mieridduryn as an Opabiniid is not beyond question. Some of the animal's features are undoubtedly reminiscent of the family. It had rows of flaps, a flexible proboscis, and a backward-facing mouth. But on the contrary, its fossils show no sign of the five eyes present in Utaurora and Opabinia, with its head instead bearing what appears to be a rounded armour plate. And the possibility remains that Mieridduryn may not be an Opabiniid, but part of another lineage of dinocharidids that convergently evolved a similar set of features. Even under this hypothesis, however, Mieridduryn is still quite a noteworthy find. Previously, the only dinocharidids known to have persisted beyond the Cambrian were a singular family of radiodonts known as the Herdiids, which included the giant Agirocassis benmauli and the late surviving Schinderhans Bartels eye. Mieridduryn, at the very least, shows that a greater diversity of dinocharidids made it past the Cambrian than once thought. And that's a wrap on what I hope was an adequate coverage of these fascinating animals. If you're interested in learning about some of the other strange inhabitants of the Cambrian Oceans, then feel free to check out these videos here. And if you enjoy my content, then you are warmly welcome to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.